recently a very jazzy term of nanomaterials has come into existence, and because of that, all the research and the funding has been directed to nanomaterials science and nanomanufacturing. So we will in this lecture we'll learn about what is nanomaterial and how the science is dictated by various phenomena, and how we can impart this knowledge into nanomanufacturing. So there are a couple of definitions which we need to understand before we progress into manufacturing those. So first thing is nanoscience. Nanoscience is the study, science study. So nanoscience is the study of the fundamental principles of molecules and structures which lie between size range of 1 to 100 nanometer. Correspondingly, we should not confuse it with nanostructure. Nanostructure is some sort of a structure which is a size between 1 to 100 nanometer. It can possess variety of shapes. It can be tubular, it can be quantum dot, it can be a sphere, it can even be a conical or pyramidal shape, it can be a nanoflower, any entity, any structure which is a size range between 1 to 100 nanometer, and these go into comprising what we call nanomaterials. Then there comes a term, nanotechnology and nanomanufacturing. Once we have all these nanomaterials, we need to have some sensitive instrument which can trap the nanoparticles, and it can overlay them into forming certain bigger entity. So nanotechnology is an art or an application of these nanostructures into some useful shapes which can make either components or devices to take advantage of these nanomaterials. So we learn nanoscience is the study of these materials which range between 1 to 100 nanometer. Nanostructure is some sort of a structure which is size range between 1 to 100 nanometer. And nanotechnology and nanomanufacturing is nothing but the art of applying these nanomaterials into certain useful components or devices. Once we have those nanoparticles, we want to manufacture them into some useful shapes. So there can be two different techniques of nanomanufacturing or nanofabrication. It means producing a device or component which is a size range between 1 to 100 nanometer. There is one term called top-down nanofabrication. This becomes a necessity when we have a bigger particle available with us, and any bigger entity available with us. So in this case, we start with a much bigger material. It can be a couple of micrometers, it can be millimeters or so on, and then we start breaking it down into certain size range when it comes down to 1 to 100 nanometers. So we try to make it smaller and smaller. We take a bigger particle, we can start milling it, we can start machining it, we should start impacting it so that it crumbles into very fine powder particles. So now we are making it much smaller. So we start with a bigger component, and then we start going into making it much more finer. Second one is the bottom up nanofabrication. In this case, we start with individual atoms or molecules. So we have some entity which is much smaller than nano, because all the size range of atoms and molecules is an angstrom regime. So we start building up those materials or the atoms, individual atoms or molecules, into a bigger shape. So we can see top down, we start with a bigger component, we start fracturing it or breaking it down until we get a nano crystallinity in the material or nano material out of it. So this is breaking it down into some very fine pieces which can again have some functionality. So we had some bigger chunk, and now we have some very finer chunk, and that is nothing but top down approach. And bottom up approach, we have very fine individual atoms, and then we can put them into certain structure or certain shape to give a functionality to it. So we get much finer but certain functionality to it. So in this case, we have individual atoms. They go on to arranging into some useful shape or size. That's what we can see in nanomanufacturing. We have two approaches: top-down approach, we start with a bigger component, and then we go on to forming a nanomaterial. And then bottom-up approach, in this case, we utilize individual atoms or molecules to synthesize something which is at nano scale. So in this case, certain examples of top-down approach can be mechanical milling. We start milling a bigger component, and bottom-up approach can be chemical vapor deposition or physical vapor deposition. In this case, we utilize individual atoms to start depositing on a substrate to form a nano coating. Again, nanotechnology or synthesizing nanomaterials into some useful shape is nothing but playing with atoms. Many of us have played with Legos. In that case, we take each and every block and start constructing it, so we get either buildings or dolls or some useful shape. So the similar way, this technology or art is based on manipulating individual atoms and molecules and then go on to making some very complex shapes or structures with defined atomic specification. So we have certain blocks, we can go on to making certain cars out of it or certain different structures out of it by placing each and every block into a specified location, and that goes on to forming certain bigger complex structures. So we can start depositing each and every individual atom into specified locations to make a bigger or complicated structure. It's the similar way we start playing with Lego. We take individual blocks either to make cars, robots, dolls, any bridges or something like that. So it is nothing but getting essentially every atom at the right place. So we need to take and be able to manipulate each and every atom, and that creates a difficulty because it is very hard to manipulate each and every individual atom or a molecule. So we need to have some sensitive instrument which can first of all see those nanoparticles or these atoms individually, be able to pick them and then place them into a right location. So that again provides us a challenge in order to see those nanoparticles or those individual atoms, manipulate it, have a manipulator, sort of a sub nano manipulator, to pick up these individual atoms or molecules and place them at the right place. And again, because of instability of these atoms, because as soon as we are putting an individual atom, that may not be stable. So again, that stability of atom may come into picture in nanotechnology. And again, there are certain challenges in nano manufacturing. Like in Moore's first law, it has been predicted that the amount of the space which is required to install a transistor on a chip will shrink by roughly half every 18 months. It means that we need to double the electronic components such as resistors, transistors, capacitors, everything on a smaller chip. We need to double its density every 18 months. So that's what it says, the amount of space required to install a transistor on a chip has to shrink by roughly half every 18 months. So the density has to increase very dramatically over time. Correspondingly, there is a converse or a Moore's second law which tells that the cost of building such a chip will also double every 36 months. Because if we are making a particular chip and it has certain transistors and capacitors, resistors, everything, and this density has to double, we need to somehow enhance our capability of being able to install so many components in a certain limited dimension of the chip. So if you had a dimension of x and y and we had a density of n, in this case it has to increase by twice at least, because the density has to increase. So if we are increasing density, we have to have at least 2n, and that keeps going on to 4n and so on. So that is what, and again, to synthesize or manufacture this one, the cost also will start enhancing dramatically, because once we are increasing the overall density, the overall technology has to change so that more number of transistors and such components can be installed in a similar dimension chip, and thereby it also increases the cost of that particular chip. And again, the nano manufacturing, it can again be subdivided into couple of broad categories. First thing is, once we want to manufacture something, if we want to manufacture a nano component, the first thing is we need to have nano particles available to us which can be consolidated later on. So first thing is, for synthesizing a nano material or a nano device or a nano component, first thing is we need to have a pure nanoparticle or a nanopowder, and then we need to integrate these nanoparticles or nanopowder into some bulk nanostructured component. So from nanoparticles we go on to making certain components, which can be such as aircraft brake pads or other some nano composites. So there can be individual components which should be made from these nanoparticles. And third stage is we consolidate all those nano components into certain device. Those can be electronic devices, magnetic devices, optics, or even biological devices, biomedical devices. So we can see in nano manufacturing it is not a single step process, but it requires first the processing or synthesis of nanoparticles, and again their purity, their size, their distribution is maybe also of concern. Then integration of these nanoparticles into bulk nanostructure. There are always some problems which are being imposed by these nanoparticles because of their size, because of their high surface area, and their even their handling. It can create certain problem in synthesizing them into some bulk components. And again, after they have been composed as a bulk component, making them into certain device so that they can be sensitive to some stimuli or serve as a structural material with exposure to certain temperature or mechanical stress, the overall properties of nanoparticles can themselves change. So overall functionality of these nanomaterials or nanocomponents can also change once they are composed as a device. So again, these are also certain concerns in nanomanufacturing. But as Richard Feynman has said, basically for the electronic chips, the principle of physics do not speak against the possibility of maneuvering things atom by atom. So if we can manipulate atom by atom, and then we can definitely achieve the class which we call nanomaterial. We can achieve any functionality by somehow manipulating atoms on a individual scale and then making them into certain devices or components. So let us now try to tackle each and every challenge which is being faced at individual level. So that first let us start with the challenges which are challenges associated with the synthesis of nanopowder. So first thing is synthesis of bulk amount of nanopowder. If we are trying to pick atom by atom and then try to make a nanopowder out of it, so even to make couple of grams of nanopowder we might require months, because the process is very very slow. So first thing is synthesizing nanopowder in bulk scale itself is a challenge. So we require certain technologies which can produce these powders in bulk, so that they can synthesize in large quantities, and also it has to be economic. Otherwise, if it becomes highly costly, the cost may not be supporting the its commercial viability. So that is what is required, that some technologies which can produce this nanopowders or nanoparticles in bulk. And right now these technologies are still in adolescence stage, they still need maturity. Even when we have manufactured those nanopowders, they have a tendency to agglomerate. So because of their high surface area to volume ratio, they have a tendency to agglomerate. Because of their high surface area, they tend to minimize their surface energy, so they come in contact with the nearby nanoparticles, and in turn they tend to agglomerate. So agglomeration is the inherent tendency of these powder particles. If we take a metallic nanopowder particle, they also have very high tendency to oxidize. So they can form increased surface oxidation because of the high surface is now exposed to the environment or the atmosphere. So they come in contact with oxygen and they tend to oxidize very easily. So it is very hard to even produce a pure metallic powder because they tend to form oxides. Concurrently, if the nanoparticles which are metallic in nature, if they are tendency to oxidize so rapidly because of their high surface area, it can be even very very explosive. So that it can create even explosion hazards. You might be aware that the aluminium is used as a fuel in the rocket engines because of its inherent oxidation tendency, and nano aluminium powder particles, they can create so much energy that it can provide an impulse to the rocket so that it can achieve very high speed. So again, so they can again have explosion hazards. So because of the high surface area which is associated with the nanoparticles, and that becomes a key issue for the metallic nanopowders. If you want to make a component out of metallic nanoparticles, first thing is they tend to oxidize, and second thing is they can be highly explosive if they come in contact with the atmosphere. So for handling all this, we need an inert atmosphere where we can handle them, as well as then we can start synthesizing them. Then comes the problem of handling and storage, because again these nanoparticles, we need some space for storing them. If we have to create an inert atmosphere for so huge of a powder particle, so much of a huge powder bulk, then it requires much space, and it also becomes costly to store and handle these materials. Even while handling, if you are exposing them to atmosphere, it is creating surface oxides. It also poses a threat of explosion. So we need to take care of all these concerns. So there are many challenges which are associated with the synthesis of nanopowder. First thing is being able to produce in a bulk quantity, and then avoiding the agglomeration of these nano-sized powders, and somehow trying to limit the surface oxidation which is inherently there in the nanopowder particles. It can also create explosion hazards, and also we need to minimize the cost and the handling and storage issues which are there with the nanopowders. Again, one more concern with the nanopowders is this the biosafety. Because the nanopowder particles, if they go in our lungs, it is very hard for them to come out. So we need proper safety protocols which are required, like the person has to be under proper safety protocols, wearing safety gadgets, all the masks which will not allow nanoparticles to seep through the filters or respiratory filters. At the same time, they should not be getting touch with our skin or something like that, to avoid any irritation or their inducing toxicity effects to our body. So there are many challenges which are associated with the nanopowder particles, and all of these are basically being listed here. Now coming to the second stage, in terms of processing them. So once we have the nanopowder particles, we want to consolidate them into certain device or components. So there are certain challenges, challenges associated with the consolidation of nanopowders. The first thing is, as soon as we expose these nanopowder particles to high temperatures, it undergoes severe grain growth. Overall identity of the nanoparticle is lost. If it starts growing, it becomes enhanced. The size of this nanoparticles enhances, it has lost the characteristic of the nanoparticle. So we want to avoid the severe grain growth which is now inherent in the nanopowder particles via conventional processing. Second thing is, it also can undergo very non-uniform bulk transformation. Because surface is highly active, it might be much more prone to surface reconstruction as well as transformation. So it can render very non-uniform bulk transformation. Apparently, the mechanical properties of the nanopowder particles will vary drastically. Up to a certain size range, if you start reducing the grain size, it will enhance the overall hardness and the strength of the material. But after a certain size range, say below 10 to 15 nanometer, if you go much below the grain size of 10 to 15 nanometer, there is not enough grain area to support the pileup of dislocations. So in turn, it starts reducing the overall strength of the material. That is called inverse Hall patch relationship. But still now the conventional knowledge was, if you start reducing the grain size, it enhances the strength of the material. But in nanomaterials, the problem can be inverse Hall patch relationship. It means the overall strength of the material starts degrading with the decrease in the grain size. So again, that may not be good for the longevity or lifetime of the nano device or nano component. Again, there exists a lack of consolidation technique to fabricate large components. Till now, the research has been directed to make very small pieces or discs of these nano components, which can go as a maybe couple of millimeters or centimeters in that scale. The research has been directed, and there is no commercial technique available to make bulk nanostructures. Only a limited of such techniques might be available. but there is an overall limitation of synthesizing these nanoparticles into some bigger entities. And again, so that again is a challenge which is associated with the processing. And for that, the manufacturing cost also should not basically exceed the cost of the required raw material and energy. So in order to maintain a balance and so that it can be easily commercialized later on. So manufacturing cost also has to be limited and it should be well below the cost of the raw material itself. That is again a challenge for the processing of nanomaterial. Then challenge associated with the nano manufacturing of devices. If you want to create a device or a nano device, first thing is we need an interdisciplinary approach, because it requires knowledge of materials, knowledge of processing, and also where it is going to be used. If it is an electronic industry, it's a biomedical industry, where is it, or electrical industry. So we need to have an interdisciplinary approach in terms of the material itself, what are the physics which is governing the overall functionality, then materials, processing, and again the exact point where we are going to use this particular device. So we need a combination of knowledge of these all areas to be able to make such a device, and also requires flexibility to operate smartly and also communicate and interface with the other nano systems, because once the device itself is nano, it definitely needs to have some sensors or some connectors which are again nano in size. Then only it makes sense to use these nano devices. So it requires a very good connectivity with those systems so that it can communicate and interface with them, and it can send the required information to the external world. So in terms of packaging and interconnecting, again it becomes a challenge. Then the reduced dimension also induces some different sort of responses with respect to the ordinary size components. Like in this case, reduced dimension, they result enhanced friction in the nano devices, because of their very very low size. Once they come in contact with other devices, the overall surface area is so high that the overall friction among the devices or the moving parts becomes extremely large. And then it requires the need for improved tooling or computer-aided design for their design. So we utilize novel software for nano machining and focused ion beam and ultra fast laser for certain machining as well. And again, the Moore's law, to maintain with the Moore's law or the prediction, there is always a thrust which is there to go into miniaturizing all these components. So there is again certain pressure to be able to reach that particular level which has been predicted by the Moore's law. So we can see there are certain challenges that we want to go for very lighter and lighter devices and components. So we need to keep the pace with it in terms of manufacturing it. So we require interdisciplinary ways, we require much more flexibility, we require that they can communicate or interface with the adjoining external world, be able to reduce the dimension and come up with some improved tooling such as focused ion beam or even ultra fast lasers to be able to keep pace with the technology. So there are certain key issues which are existing in this nanomaterials. First thing is the preservation of the nanostructures. For successful consolidation of nanomaterials into bulk size components, we need to preserve the nanostructure so the properties of nanomaterials can be retained. And secondly, the most challenging problem in the nanocrystalline particle consolidation is the inability to fabricate sufficiently large parts. So we need a technique to make these nanoparticles into bigger components, bigger or bulk or large components which can be of usable size. So right now we can make small particles or devices which are functional, but it is very hard to create a functional bulk material or a bigger functional component such as chair or such as elevators which can be made up entirely of these nanoparticles. So the challenge is in terms of enhancing the scale at which the nanomaterials are being synthesized into useful components. The conventional consolidation of powder particles has not been that alluring, because in traditional consolidation techniques, it is hard to retain the size of nanophase. The nanophase or the nanoparticles inherently undergo grain growth, and again it can also lead to inherent nanostructural instability. So nanostructure may not remain stable even if there are certain processing techniques through which we can produce them, but they still remain unstable during the consolidation process. Even powder metallurgy, it utilizes high temperatures or elevated temperatures for prolonged duration of time, and that creates a diffusional mechanism so that the overall distribution of these nanoparticles, it becomes much more homogeneous, or it can also be, it can basically go through or diffuse through the nearby phase, and it can again lead to inhomogeneity. The inhomogeneous part can be basically not be retained at the interface. So that is the problem with the powder metallurgy technique. Again, the sintering of nano versus micro. So there are very conflicting theories on how these nanocrystalline materials sinter. The conventional knowledge on the sintering is very, very different, but when it comes to nano, the overall sintering kinetics itself is very, very rapid and very, very different than what is being suggested for the bulk or the macro materials. Nanoparticles, again, they have very high tendency to agglomerate. And there is one more problem with the nanoparticles is they are very high interparticle friction. So it is very hard to obtain enhanced density. Again, there is very high reactivity. So because of that, the nanoparticles also undergo high contamination. The surface oxidation or grabbing of some impurities from the atmosphere or even from the overall nearby container, it can also react and grab some impurity and it gets contaminated. But on the sintering part, because of their high surface area, it also undergoes rapid sintering, and it also incurs rapid grain growth. So these are certain problems which are associated with the nano and micro sintering, that there are various conflicting theories on the sintering of nanoparticles. They have tendency to agglomerate, they render very high interparticle friction, they have tendency to get contaminated because of their high reactivity, but they also undergo very rapid sintering and they undergo rapid grain growth, which may not be required to acquire their useful properties. The nanoparticles, they generally show very depressed onset of sintering temperature. It occurs at as low as 0.2 to 0.3 TM, or the melting point, the 0.2 or 2.3 times that of a melting temperature. Whereas for conventional materials, for conventional powders, the sintering starts at between 0.5 to 0.8 of the melting temperature. So that is the key role of nanomaterials, that they tend to sinter at even very low temperatures. So they can start solid, they can start consolidating at very lower temperatures. The sintering starts, it onsets at very in the initial stages itself, and such results is attributed to the structural instability of these nanoparticles because of their high surface area. Because of their high surface area, they come in contact with the nearby particles and they incur various phenomena which we'll be discussing in a few later on in a few slides. But because of that, it can initiate or actuate these processes of solidification, of densification, as early as 0.2 to 0.3 times the melting temperature. And this occurs because they are fundamentally very energetic and they also render accelerated kinetics. So because of their high surface area and their structural instability, this is basically provides the accelerated kinetics or very high energetics to undergo sintering and consolidation or even grain growth. Again, when the nanoparticles are getting agglomerated, there is the overall pore distribution of the nanoparticles also is of very high concern. Generally, the smaller the particle, the larger the agglomerate. Because if the particle size is very, very small, they have very high surface area and they tend to render very high surface forces, and in turn, they form a very bigger chunk of the material or a very bigger agglomerate. And again, there are very small pores within the agglomerate. These are called inter-agglomerate pores. And again, there are some pores which are very large in size and they are intra agglomerate pores. These are porosity between certain agglomerates, and such a distribution will alter the overall packing density because there is now bimodal size of distribution of the porosity, and again because of the high friction which is associated with the nanoparticles, it can alter the densification mechanism. So we can see the smaller the particle, larger the forces, because of that it gives out very bigger agglomerate. Then there are smaller pores within the agglomerate, there are larger pores between the agglomerates, and smaller pores within the agglomerate, and this distribution will lead to change in the densification mechanism, and it will alter the packing density of these nanoparticles. So we can see the bimodal pore distribution of nanoparticles. It can be like this, that we have an agglomerate. We have an agglomerate. Then we can also have a second agglomerate which is out, which comes in contact. Then we might have a third agglomerate which basically comes in contact like this. Maybe fourth agglomerate which comes in contact like this. So we can see that we have some porosity within the agglomerate which is called intra agglomerate porosity. This entire thing is nothing but a agglomerate, and then these are nothing, individually they are called either crystallite or primary particle. And once we have this agglomerate, there is so much space which is available, so much space which is available out here. This space, this is nothing but inter-agglomerate porosity. Inter-agglomerate porosity. So we can see there is some porosity between the powder particle, between the particles or the crystallite, which is called intra-agglomerate because this is within a agglomerate. And then we have between the agglomerates, it is called inter-agglomerate porosity. So we can see the and there is a bimodal pore distribution because the size of this particular porosity, the intra-agglomerate porosity is much smaller, is very very smaller than the inter-agglomerate porosity. So we can see there is much difference in the size range of this porosity, which is intra-agglomerate porosity, and then the inter-agglomerate porosity. So that in turn provides a distribution of pores which is in, one is within the agglomerate, so within the agglomerate because of porosity, because of intra-agglomerate porosity, these particles will undergo certain shift and it will lead to friction. And second friction arises because of the link between the different agglomerates. So there can be again friction along this side between agglomerate 1 and agglomerate 2. Again we will see, we will observe some friction between them, and that arises because of the inter-agglomerate porosity. So there is a gap between the agglomerates that gives out the inter-agglomerate porosity, and that again reduces some friction. And the friction because of this entity might be much higher. The movement of individual powder particles, it can render very high frictional forces, and that will make the flow of these particles very very viscousy, or very very it will basically stop the movement between the powder particles, and that creates a problem in the flow of these powder particles. If you want to fill a cavity for compression or hot pressing or something like that, it won't be that uniform. So that is the reason the nanoparticles they need to be treated so that they can become an agglomerate, spherical agglomerate, and somehow they can reduce the overall friction between the particles. And out here as well, they have very high tendency to remain in touch with the other particle, so the movement between those particles will be very very limited. Now comes the consolidation of nanoparticles, and as we said, because of this porosity and the overall surface forces, it becomes very hard to move the particles in relation to each other. So that gives a very high frictional forces. And since the density of the green component, compact depends on the frictional forces, it becomes very hard to compress them to very high density. And that basically originates from the electrostatic or van der Waal forces or the surface adsorption phenomena. And these frictional forces are extremely high in the nanoparticles. They form very hard agglomerate and inter-agglomerate porosity, which is basically very, very large. So in turn, it's very hard to move those powder particles and then result a very dense compact out of it. So we require very additional pressures to make them move and consolidate to a very high dense pellet or a component. So the consolidation of nanoparticles, it's of a bigger concern, because the overall frictional forces are very, very high, and in turn it requires very, very high forces to consolidate into dense particles. Coming to the thermodynamics consideration for the pore consolidation, so based on the overall size of the pore, so we can see that the thermodynamic treatment can provide that the shrinkage of pore occurs and it requires very high pressures. So the finer the pore size usually yields the highest densification rate. So we can see that if the pore size is very, very fine, it can easily get consumed by the surrounding. And the larger pores require not only higher temperature but also prolonged sintering times for their complete engulfment. So consequently, it becomes very difficult to retain the grain size in the nanometer regime. So we can see, first of all, that the nanoparticles, if you have a cluster of nanoparticles, the finer grains are present within an agglomerate, and it is very easy to eliminate these nanopores or make them densified very quickly. So these porosities will go first. So in turn, the nano nature of this is a nanoparticle and this is a nanoporosity. So these will get consumed first. So we can get a agglomerate, a densified agglomerate, and then we have second densified agglomerate and a third densified agglomerate. So the overall grain size is now increased, and in turn it has become difficult to retain the nano particles or nano grains. So the consolidation of nanoparticles or reduction or retention of the grain size is very, very difficult in the nanometer regime. And this, once it forms a bigger pore, it becomes very hard to consume it and densify the material. So in the process, we are not only consuming the finer grains or finer particles, we are also being able to we are also inducing certain porosity in the material, which is very hard to eliminate. So that is the requirement for the pore consolidation. So we need to have a very uniform size of pore throughout the material in order to retain the nanometer grain size while achieving a rapid sintering. So rapid sintering becomes of key issue, that we can achieve densification in very short duration of time while retaining the nano grains in the structure. Again, why the vapor pressure of nanoparticles basically increases, that occurs because if you have a smaller particle and a bigger particle, first of all, the flat surface will remain in equilibrium with the vapor. As soon as the size is changing, the free energy also keeps changing. The smaller the ball, the higher the free energy which is associated with the finer particle. So the vapor pressure around the smaller ball has to increase, and this pressure, whether for gas or for particle, the overall pressure basically is a function of the inverse of the radius. So smaller the radius, higher will be the vapor pressure. So in turn, this entity, the smaller entity, will render much more vapor pressure, and then it will have very high energetics in terms of its growth or consolidation. So that is the problem associated with the nanoparticles, but then in turn it also yields very rapid kinetics for sintering. So we can see the smaller particle, it has a direct dependence on the radius, inverse relationship with the radius. So higher the
are lower within the vapor pressure. So, flat surfaces will be in equilibrium with the vapor, whereas smaller entities, smaller particles, they have very small radius. So, in turn it will tend to increase the vapor pressure. And sintering mechanism, this sintering starts now occurring in the, even when the earlier stage of sintering, even when the temperature is around 0.2 to 0.3 times the melting temperature. So, overall lower activation energy is needed because of their high vapor pressure, and overall even it is even lower than that is required for the conventional diffusion. So, for example, of tungsten powder of size 40 nanometer, the activation energy is approximately 134 kilojoules per mole, and that is very, very low even when it, when you compare it either with the lattice diffusion or even when you consider it with the surface diffusion. So, that is the kind of energy which is even lesser than the half of the surface diffusion. So, even surface diffusion cannot explain the overall densification which is occurring in the nano tungsten powder. So, even high diffusivity of this tungsten powder particle cannot be explained by the surface diffusion because of the high energetics associated with the nanoparticle. So, even when we are able to achieve extremely fast sintering in the tungsten particle, we cannot explain it using conventional wisdom of either lattice diffusion or even by surface diffusion. So, that requires that we explain these phenomena of sintering via some additional diffusion mechanisms. So, we can see the sintering mechanisms, it starts occurring in the early stages as early as 0.2 to 0.3 times the melting temperature, and requires activation energy which are much smaller than that required for either for surface diffusion or even for the lattice diffusion. So, these phenomena become unexplainable via conventional cognizance. So, we require to explain them with some other diffusion mechanisms. So, we can see that other diffusion mechanisms of these nanoparticles, they have been explained via certain molecular dynamics through which we can really see what is happening in the material. So, first thing is the rapid dislocation motion. So, once the dislocation is generated in the material via the interfacing of these nanoparticles, the dislocation created at the interface starts moving very rapidly, and that leads to rapid shrinkage or densification. Second thing is grain itself can start rotating. The first case, rapid dislocation, grain itself can start rotating, the grain can also slip, and again dislocation density is again driven by contact Hertzian stresses that exceed the shear strength. So, before the shear strength starts dominating, the Hertzian stress itself is now available for the deformation of the material, and then to yield the to let the dislocation density change the structure of the material itself and lead to densification. And after the neck forms, the adjacent powder particle can also rotate to achieve a minimum grain boundary energy. So, let us see them in point by point. That rapid dislocation movement. So, as soon as you have a contact of the two powder particles, the dislocation which is created at the interface because of the different orientation, the dislocation itself can move very rapidly. Now, the grains themselves can now rotate. So, once you have some deformation achieved at the necking, this entire grain can rotate and result a much more denser interface. Grain boundary slip, the grain boundary because of the temperature, the grain boundary can also start slipping, and the overall trace can be also obtained using this using the movement of the two different powder particles. And rapid dislocation density is driven by the Hertzian stresses, it is no more by limited by the shear strength of the material, it exceeds the shear strength of the material, and because of contact Hertzian stresses which are developed at the interface, they lead the movement of rapid dislocation density. And again, once the crack has the neck has formed, the particles can also rotate to achieve a minimum grain boundary energy. So, we can see initially when we have two powder particles, they might have different orientation of grains, and first thing is there is overall movement of this dislocation density itself. So, they come in contact, they start forming neck, and then this dislocation now start moving to some location, so that you have some development of extra material, and that extra material now can allow it slipping. So, the grain rotation can also occur to come and join the interface. So, now in turn you have prolonged neck area, So the overall neck area enhances because of the movement or the grain rotation itself. So in first case you have movement of dislocation, and second case you can also have grain rotation, and it can in turn it can also lead to the twin boundaries or even dislocations in the final material. But now it has come to a much more denser state, and in this case again we can see much more the overall grain orientation or the grain size can also be very different than the starting material. So we can see that in this case we can again have some sort of a orientation resemblance in the final stage. So in this case the over initial grain orientation was very different, the overall planarity was very different. In this case we see the movement of dislocations, and even the grain rotation has occurred in one case, so that we can achieve a certain similarity near the neck region. And also this neck area, which was basically been promoted by the movement of dislocation, and that comes in contact with the other grain, and in turn we can achieve very rapid densification via sintering of nanoparticles. And again in sintering of nanoparticles there are very conflicting stories, and there is no single story which is available to universally explain what is happening in the nanomaterials. So there are variety of phenomena which might be dominant in the nanomaterials. They can range from the moment of dislocations to what is happening at the grain, either it is by surface diffusion or by the rotation of grain, or it is by the Hertzian contact which enhances the moment of these dislocations. There are many conflicting theories which describe the sintering in nanoparticles, and any one of them might be much more dominant in one set of systems in comparison to the other set of systems. So there is no single theory which is able to explain the overall densification and grain growth and even the sintering of nanoparticles. Most of these techniques have some success as well as certain limitations, but one common feature of these techniques is that the application of sudden pressure, temperature or other processing variables. So in the consolidation we can apply a sudden pressure, a sudden temperature, or the cooling rates are very sharp or very high, or any other processing variable. So either the time is very short, the pressure is very short, or the temperature is attained in a very short duration of time. So these sudden jerks can allow the retention of these nanoparticles in the sintered component. But again the major conclusion which can come out of is that the synthesis of nanocomposites is much more feasible than that of a pure metal or a alloy, because of the high surface reactivity metal and always undergoes certain reactions, oxidation, and also starts getting some impurity. Whereas in case of nanocomposites we are already inducing certain inhomogeneity in the system. So in that case it becomes much more feasible for the component to attach itself to a different species and then react with it and then again get densified. So the overall synthesis of nano composites is much more feasible, and also it renders enhanced mechanical properties or enhanced surface properties in comparison to that of a pure metal or an alloy. So in this case in the consolidation we are applying a rapid rate of either pressure or temperature or even the deformation or any time which is associated with this processing. So in summary we can see that the nano manufacturing is a challenge, because we need to incorporate, first of all we need to make those nanoparticles, then be able to process them, and then make them into a useful shape which is much bigger in size so that it can be used effectively. So it requires the retention of nano domains, and again there are certain challenges with each and every stage of this nano manufacturing in terms of either handling the powders, being able to manufacture them, the oxidation, the surface reactivity. Then when it comes to devices, again there might be certain challenges of interconnects and the kind of getting signals out of them, making them into certain useful shape. Then again components, it can again be a challenge because the overall pressure, temperature, the working environment can also induce certain effects and it might become very hard to merge those nano components into a bulk or a useful shape. Then comes the rapid sintering of nanoparticles. This can also create certain challenge because retention of nanoparticles is very, very difficult. Since the nanopores which are present between the nanoparticles, they are very easy to get consumed, whereas the porosity between the agglomerates, it is very hard to eliminate. So, in turn, the rapid sintering or the rapid jerk, which can be applied via pressure, temperature, or even by consolidation, it requires a jerk or a short pulse so that they can be retained and the process can get completed in a very short duration of time. And in nanoparticles, additional diffusional mechanism also become predominant, such as dislocation movement, which becomes very, very rapid, the Hertzian contact, which can enhance the overall movement between the dislocation density, and again there can be grain rotation to yield to a enhanced densification of these nanoparticles. So, we can see the overall nano manufacturing is totally dependent on the nano materials. Synthesizing them into certain devices becomes again a very big challenge, and that requires understanding of the mechanisms or the sintering mechanisms which are dominant in terms of creating this functional devices. With this, I end my lecture. Thank you.